Ollie, ready to check some messages from our fans?
Your soul is mine.
Yeah, let's check some messages.
Sophie, there must have been more than 2 requests for Majora's Mask. That's like half my fan base, Sophie. What do?
I have taught you much, my son, but now you know what you must do. You must face your true fears.
You're right, puppy, with an extremely unfitting voice.
I know what I must do.
Hey guys, it's been too long, huh? Thanks for making me look cool, Corey.
No problem!
So, as an apology for the delay, I think it's prime time to tackle a game you've all been waiting for since I first started this little shitstorm. And since this is apparently apocalypse season, according to people who don't know how to read a Mayan calendar, the time just felt right. You see this? If you grew up with the game I'm about to cover and have any innocent perceptions of it, I highly suggest you leave the room before my analysis makes you cry tears of blood and disappointment, because I'm about to obliterate your innocence. Enjoy! It's about time, huh? The Legend of Zelda, Majora's Mask, was a direct sequel to its predecessor, Ocarina of Time. It came out in the year 2000 and was one of the last major releases for the N64. It's also quite possibly the most atmospheric, haunting, and thought-provoking installment in the Zelda series to this day. And that's saying something. See, Ocarina might have dealt with much more adult themes than its predecessors, but Majora really ramped up the subtext, which is probably why I've gotten so many requests for it, and why it's one of my personal favorite games. Because I'm fat and pretentious like that. Majora's Mask is an extremely unique game in just about every regard, especially its basic story structure. You're still saving the world at the end of the day, yes, but the story is much more focused on getting to know individual people and helping them on a smaller scale. It's a truly intimate game. Putting aside my cheesy intro, I really have gotten dozens of requests for this one game, even more so than the Persona and Silent Hill games, believe it or not. And Majora is sorta different from previous installments on the show, too. You see, I've talked about games that you wouldn't think have much subtext at all, and games that are so in your face with the subtext that it's not really subtext anymore, but Majora doesn't fit into either of those categories. The reason Majora is such a frequent request is that it's clearly about something. Something profound, but it's subtle enough to not be painfully obvious. It's cryptic, unsettling, and well, it's a tough cookie to crack. Putting aside hurricanes and blizzards and computer problems, this review did take me a while to make, simply because it's a pretty complex topic. But it's also a beautiful and genuinely thoughtful one. And I think it's the most emotional game Nintendo has ever made. So let's dive in. Right from the get-go, it's implied that this is a more personal journey for Link. The intro sequence reveals that Navia's disappeared and assures me that I care enough to go look for her. Link gets tricked and robbed by a very strange trio of bandits led by a very unsettling creature. Skull Kid, the forest spirit, steals Link's horse, Ocarina, and apparently every other tool they acquired in the last game, and you chase after him to learn that Skull Kid is more than just a little prankster. The sprite has some real power at his disposal. Without any warning, Skull Kid suddenly starts to place a mysterious spell on Link, resulting in a bizarre dream sequence. Oh god, is this what Charlie Sheen sees when he goes for a walk in the woods? Link wakes up to find that he's been transformed into a Deku Scrub, a sentient plant creature. He doesn't take the news very well. Skull Kid then ditches the area, forcing you to fight your way out with the assistance of Tattle, one of the fairies that was initially helping Skull Kid, though she seems confused by his recent behavior, and maybe even a little bit afraid of him. You find a strange tree with a very sullen face that somewhat resembles Deku Link. More on that later. Then we meet this guy. On your way out of the mysterious clock tower, you bump into the completely trustworthy mask salesman, who promises that if you get back the ocarina and the mask from the Skull Kid and return to him, he can restore Link back to his normal form. And since becoming a shrub has interfered with Link's practical reasoning skills, he trusts him. Good idea, buddy. And with all that plot out of the way, now we can finally get into the symbolism, and the game dives right in, introducing Link to Clock Town. Time is another very important motif in this game. It's worth noting that both the N64 Zelda games were actually about the same topic, but were just addressing different things about it. They're both about time, and something that inevitably happens because of it. Ocarina of Time was about coming of age, accepting more responsibility, growing up, the fact that the world changes around you and you need to adapt. Majora's Mask was about a very different consequence of time, a much darker one. And I think most of you already know where I'm going with this. But forget about all that serious stuff, man. This is such a happy game in a happy little town. Look at all the people running around keeping busy. There's creepy old men in spandex, racist school children, women without pants, and dogs trying to slaughter me. It's like graduation all over again. Oh, dude, there's gonna be a festival? A carnival? That's awesome! I love carnivals! I can't wait to... Scary moon? What are you guys talking about? The moon isn't... Oh. That.
Probably should have noticed that.
Now, the moon is visible throughout the entire game, and as you play, you can't help but notice it getting closer and closer to Earth. With its grim expression and foreboding nature, it's the most noticeable symbol in the entire game. That's right. Febreze, save the world. Take that, Mayans. But you know. So in order to unravel the mysteries of Majora's Mask, we need to ask ourselves the same questions that's been plaguing gamers' minds for 12 years. Namely, why God why? Why did you do this to me, Nintendo? I'll never sleep again. Why God why? We're getting a little ahead of ourselves here, but almost everywhere you go in Termina, you can still see the terrifying face of the moon, looming over with its threatening expression. In other words, the moon functions as a constant reminder of the danger the world faces. In a more figurative sense, it represents the constant fear of death. Yes, death. This game is about death. All its core themes, all of its primary morals and plot twists all revolve around the inevitability that everyone is eventually going to die. You know, for kids. Anyway, you soon find out that Skull Kid is on top of the clock tower. You confront the baddie in person and get a strange hint from Tattle's brother Tail. That's not clever, Nintendo. Telling you to bring the four in order to save the world from the moon. After some stuff happens I don't feel like summarizing, you learn how to reset time to 3 days ago and prevent the moon from falling. From then on, you do this repeatedly until you realize the correct sequence of events in order to save the world. Now this setup of 3 days repeating infinitely until you eventually figure out exactly what to do and get everything you need has been both criticized and praised. So, why did they do this? This game has two main themes. Like I said, one of them is death, but death itself isn't what people fear, is it? They fear loss. They fear the end of experience, the end of relationships, the end of family, love, pain, etc. Death represents the end of these things. The other theme of this game is empathy, and the connections people form, meaning that this humble little Nintendo game is deconstructing the relationship between death and love. In the world of Termina, time is fleeting, and that puts more emphasis on both the good and bad elements of life, and reveals just how people behave when life comes down to the wire. But the player can't possibly see everything the game has to offer in just 3 in-game days, so this time structure gives them the chance to get to know everyone on the planet better. And when you see people go through their daily struggles and start to understand what they're going through, what they're doing, and why they're doing it, it makes you care more about the people you're helping. It makes you care about the world you're saving, as well as just the people you're assisting with simple side quests. But that's a theme more for the next episode, where I talk more about the individual masks. This one is more about Skull Kid and the Moon. So, let's get back on track. Now that you have your ocarina back, the game reinforces the themes of kindness and empathy when the Happy Mask Salesman teaches you the soothing, yet haunting melody that the game is most famous for, the Song of Healing. A strange scene results from playing the music. I remember when my doctor made me say goodbye to my hallucinations. Link returns to his original form and obtains the Mystic Deku Mask, a mask imbued with the spirit of a Deku Scrub. Link gets various other masks like this later on that allow him to transform into various different races. Each mask, even the ones that don't transform you, have a story to it, and they usually represent a bond with a particular character. I don't feel like spoiling the big twist to the masks until part 2 where I can really focus on them, but for now, think of the mask as a way of stepping into someone else's shoes and, sometimes quite literally, seeing the world from their eyes. It's worth noting that people will treat you differently depending on what race you are. Now, this is a lot more effective at conveying the idea of racism than just briefly mentioning, oh yeah, discrimination exists, or showing another character get treated poorly. It reveals all the nuances of the world, how people view each other, who's open-minded, who isn't, etc. And you get to view it from the first person, from all sorts of different perspectives and all kinds of different situations. And this wouldn't be possible if you just played the entire game from a human perspective. But in the world of Termina, there's a bigger threat on the horizon than racism and discrimination. The Happy Mask Salesman is less than thrilled when he finds out that you did not successfully get the mask back, and he explains why. The salesman reveals the true danger of the powerful artifact in question. The titular mask is an age-old relic of an ancient tribe historically used in hexing rituals. The source of Majora's power is never made completely clear, but it is implied that certain things give it more power. And my personal theory is that it feeds off chaos and discontent in the heart of its current user, which, as it turns out, makes Skull Kid a perfect catalyst to unlock the mask's true power. Let's talk about that. You might be wondering how I'm so sure that the main themes are death and love and the relationship between them. Well, oddly enough, a lot of it all comes down to the hints provided by this very attractive older woman, and the stories she has to tell. If you get a very creepy and possibly suggestive mask, you can listen to her stories all the way through. There are 2 stories she reads, the first one being about the festival in Clocktown, which is nifty and all, but the much more important one talks about the legend of the 4 giants. Now, I pretty much need to read almost all of this, while providing text commentary in order to point out the important symbolism, so to keep things interesting, I'll read it with a terrible Christopher Walken impersonation. And now, story time with Christopher Walken.
Hello, children. Once upon a time, long ago, all the different races of Termina lived together peacefully. And the 4 giants watched over them. The giants promised to protect the people whenever they needed them. Everything was groovy. But then, one day, the giants said, "We have decided to watch over and protect the land as we sleep." And they left the four corners. They left two of the four corners of the earth. Sorry. But there was one little spirit who was saddened by this. A little imp. This little imp was friends with all the giants since before the dawn of time. Before that, it's old. And he was sad to see his friends depart. This childhood friend felt neglected, and in his anger, he spread discontent all throughout the four lands. He was being a real dick. The giants grew tired of his bullshit and attacked the imp, saying, "Leave this place or we shall tear you apart." Sad at how he had grown apart from his friends, the death threat probably didn't help. The imp left the land and was never heard from again. Or was he? Wink, wink. And they all lived happily ever after the end. Pay me! You had one job. One!
I guess it's obvious who the imp is, considering the artwork. So in summary, Skull Kid is just a lonely guy who's taking his frustrations out on other people. On a grand scale. An apocalyptic scale. But in a later flashback, where Tattle is reminiscing of old times with her friend, it's revealed that Skull Kid isn't somehow extremely cruel or evil or conniving. He seems like a misunderstood prankster. And when we get to the conclusion, he can seem downright innocent and sympathetic, seemingly being corrupted by the artifact. And to wrap up this episode, let's take a nice big look at the design of the mask itself. The most noticeable feature is the eyes. They have a stinging, haunting, perpetual stare, as if gazing upon something with unrelenting hatred. Hatred and contempt for life is something very relevant to Majora's ambition. And that cold stare is shared with the moon. They have very similar gazes. The mask itself is shaped like a heart when you really look at it, but there are various thorn-like objects bursting out of the heart shape, conjuring up the image of a damaged or corrosive heart. This matches up with the heartbreak Skull Kid felt when his friends, the giants, left him, with the thorns indicating his abrasive nature as well as his own personal pain, and the pain that he causes the people he's close to, such as the fairies Tattle and Tail. The mask wasn't made by Skull Kid, but from an artist's perspective, it's clear to see just how much thought was put into this object's design. It's very symbolic of the character's internal conflict.
Well, that's all for now, so join us next time for part 2, where we talk about the symbolism of the masks, the music, and the conflicts of all the different regions of Termina. We've seen what happens when someone is forced to part with their friends and copes with it in the worst way. But soon we'll see how other characters cope with the loss of their loved ones. And I think we all know how it feels to lose something we care about.
Fine, don't be in the shot, Ollie. Anyway, if you enjoyed this, you can click this. It's an analytical playthrough of Catherine, and it's sort of like an improv version of Panalysis with text edited in and analyzing the symbolism as we go, frame by frame, essentially. People seem to like it, so check that out. It's on my other channel, Modestly Prophetic, which gets updated so much more frequently than this one. It's not even funny, because Panalysis takes way too long to make. I'll put another video somewhere with a previous installment of the series. I don't feel like pointing anywhere. And if you enjoyed this, subscribe for more Majora and more video game analysis in general. Thank you all for an amazing year and all the ridiculous amounts of support I've been getting. See you soon. Happy Hanukkah. I point at the tree. I point at, like, Happy Hanukkah, you know.
It's way past Hanukkah.
Be quiet, Ollie.
I
shouldn't have taught you how to talk. Bye. Click things. Bye. Hmm.